are in a little series entitled The Questions That Jesus Asked. And so far we've had a little look at a couple of these questions. We've looked at Jesus asking Peter, "Do you love me?" And then last week we thought a little bit about worry and anxiety with Jesus asking that question, "Why do you worry?" Today we come to the next of these questions entitled, "Has no one condemned you?" And as we've just seen, Jesus is had a conversation with, an encounter with a bunch of religious leaders, the Pharisees, and this woman, this poor woman who was kind of found out, if you like, and brought before Jesus with a difficult situation unfolding. And so we're going to think this morning about condemnation and freedom from it, because I think it's what Jesus brings to us today. It's that reality that it's easy to forget, particularly when we live in a world that's fairly condemnatory, and maybe we're fairly condemnatory even about ourselves. I wonder if you've ever been found out or caught out in any way. When I was at school, there was a moment when me and a bunch of friends were messing about with cutlery, as you do when you're a teenage boy. And this friend of mine kind of gave me this knife as little cutlery, and everybody was messing around with these bits of cutlery, spoons and forks. And I took this knife and I held it and I went, way, like that. And as I went, way, it came out of my hand and smashed two fluorescent sort of tubes like these ones up here. It was quite impressive, I felt, in the moment. I had a moment just to be self-congratulatory, going, wow, that was pretty impressive. Smashed two of these. And as it smashed, this glass went everywhere. Teacher walked in at that very moment. And there was nowhere to go, nowhere to run, nowhere to hide, no excuse that would work. All I had to do was just to simply say, I've been found out, caught in the act of smashing up a classroom. Sometimes, for all of us, we're in that dynamic of how can I live life and not be found out? The things that may have affected us in our lives, the things that we may have thought or said or done, how can I live life in a way that I'm not found out? Many of us live under the pressure of imposter syndrome. You know, how can I live life not being found out? And here we have in John chapter 8, one of those found out moments. Jesus' encounter with this lady, caught in an uncompromising situation, or maybe a compromising situation. And Jesus, who has been in Jerusalem, for the Feast of Tabernacles, he's been there for days teaching and encouraging people, talking to them around the temple and in Jerusalem. He's been aware, and as you read through John's gospel, as you read through the first part of John's gospel, you see a number of plots beginning to unfold. How can they trap Jesus? How can the religious leaders get him to a place where there's no way out, where he can be arrested? And already, even though we're only in John chapter 8, those plots are beginning to unfold. There's anger. There's disputes. There's anger at the words of Jesus. There's anger at the people that he hangs out with. There's anger at his teaching. And just before John chapter 8, it says that Jesus retreated. John chapter 8, the first bit, Jesus, after everybody went home, after a day of discussing, arguing and listening, they all go home. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. It was a famous place for him. It was a place of retreat, a place of solitude, a place that he would return to many times, including in that last week of his life. Jesus goes to the Mount of Olives. Doesn't say what happens there, but I'm guessing he prays. He was enjoying the fellowship with the Father, maybe some silence. And he comes out of that moment into this scenario. Thank you. Into this scenario with these religious leaders who appear in the temple courts with people gathering around Jesus And Jesus teaching them again at dawn, it says. So if you feel that 10:30 in the morning is a bit of an early start, just be aware. At dawn, it says, Jesus appeared in the temple courts and he began to teach the people. They were sat down around him. And then the teachers of the law and the Pharisees arrive. What unfolds is this moment of embarrassment, this moment of challenge, this moment of what will Jesus do in this situation where the Pharisees and the teachers of the law drag a woman out from a home somewhere. They drag her across the courtyard into the temple. They throw her on the floor in front of Jesus and they explain what's gone on. We have caught this woman in the act of adultery. And they make her stand before the group and in front of Jesus. Just put yourself in her shoes for a moment. That moment of being brought in front of all those people. That moment of ultimate embarrassment, where your whole life seems to be kind of laid out in front of everybody. The most personal of details, the things that you've been thinking or saying or doing, just laid out in front of the gathered crowd. They make her stand before the group. Who knows how long they make her stand there before they say, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. Now, what do you say?" And then John writes a little subtext in verse 6. He says, "They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him." And the trap was this. If Jesus said, "Yes, stone her," they'd have said, no, we can't do that. That's the Romans' responsibility. Why would you go against the Romans, Jesus? Do you not know the land in which we live?" Trap number one. The other side of the coin was Jesus saying, "No, look, there's nothing gone on here. There's no stoning that's needed." And they would have said, but the story of Leviticus, the story of Moses says that we should. In fact, they were using part of the Bible truth. Because it says in Scripture, if they were being kind of true to that, it says that actually in this particular instance, both a man and the woman caught would both need to be tried for such an act. But Jesus finds himself in the middle of this situation. What do you do? Where do you go? What would you say next to enable a way out? And Jesus does the most astonishing of things. I noticed three things about Jesus in this story. Number one, Jesus is compassionate. They stand this woman before Jesus and they say this thing and they say, "What do you say?" And whilst we have no recounting of Jesus' immediate thoughts about this woman who stands in front of him, or on the floor in front of him, we know that Scripture tells us that Jesus lived his life in compassion for the hurting, for the lost, for the lonely, for those that everybody else ignored, for those that everybody else entrapped. Jesus lived a life of compassion. Matthew chapter 9 says this. This is kind of at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus, it says, seeing all the people, he felt compassion on them. This is a moment when the people were then fed, thousands of people fed. It says Jesus is seeing the people had compassion. Often when you think of the stories and you hear the stories of Jesus healing people, just before it says Jesus had compassion on them. So Jesus lived his life, his ministry in compassion for the people. Jesus must have looked at this woman and had compassion on her. Thrown at his feet with some accusation, maybe set up, who knows, but some accusation. And she stands or she kneels before Jesus, the one who is the Holy One, the one the rabbi, the people listen to, the one that maybe she'd been listening to over the last few days from a distance. And here she is caught in the middle of this scenario, this accusation. Jesus is compassionate. He must have looked at this woman and felt compassion. His immediate response was often that. Jesus is compassionate. Secondly, Jesus isn't compromising. Note that Jesus bends down, it says, and starts to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let any of you who is without sin throw the first stone." Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. For centuries, theologians have debated what it was that Jesus was writing. He writes twice on the ground, and we have no real way of discovering what he wrote, only a few little hints. One of the hints is the word that's used here in the Greek text for writing, and it's the word katagrapho. Grapho is where we get our word graphics from, if you like. It's katagrapho, and it literally means to write against. If you were going to write something against someone, some kind of something that was a kind of a reminder of the things that you may have thought or said wrong. It says that Jesus katagraphoed on the ground. He wrote on the ground. I wonder what it was that he wrote. Maybe he wrote, Maybe he wrote. It says that Jesus wrote against them. Maybe he looked into their eyes. Maybe he looked into their lives. He saw what was going on, and he simply wrote a list of the things that he saw were happening in that moment. Jesus wrote against. Maybe he wrote down the list of things that were happening for them: selfishness or hatred or false testimony or cheating. Maybe Jesus simply wrote down the summary of the law: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Whatever he wrote, Jesus then asked them the question: any of you who've never done any of this stuff wrong, you can throw the first stone. And it says that one by one, they began to move away. It says the older ones first. It's an interesting description, isn't it, of who went first. Remember that moment when you were much younger, maybe you're there already, where everything, you know, you were, everything is kind of, you know, you're right about everything. You know, for years I looked at my parents and thought, you know, how daft they were, you know, how little they knew about life. You know, when I was 20, I thought how little they knew. And by the time, you know, I'd got to be sort of 35 or 40, I mean, I was amazed at how much they'd learned. We all kind of maybe think we're right. And yet here is Jesus: any of you who's without sin, throw the first stone. Jesus is compassionate. Jesus was not compromising. He wasn't compromising about the people that stood before him accusing this woman. He also wasn't compromising about her. Right at the end of the story, he says, "Does nobody condemn you?" He says, "No, sir, neither do I condemn you. Go and leave your life of sin." You see, Jesus wanted more for her, wanted her to step into the future that she could have, one without abuse, one where she wasn't always at the beck and call of men, one where she could live life freely, without fear, without the expectations of others, maybe even the scarring of blame in her life. Jesus wasn't compromising. He didn't say everything that's gone on, you know, that stuff just kind of, that was all right. He says it was not great what's happened to you. Go and leave your life of sin. In other words, as you live forward, live differently. The Bible has a word for it. It's called repentance. It just means turning around and living in a different way. And there in that little moment must have been a picture of that exactly happening. Her forgetting, if you like, what had happened behind her in the past and now fixed her eyes on Jesus right in front of her. Go. Live fixed on me. Leave behind the past. I wonder how often that might be a word, or how, for how many of us that might be a word for us today. Leave behind. Leave behind and look forward. Live looking forward. Leave the stuff that hurts you. Place it at the feet of Jesus as you look to him, keeping your eyes fixed on him, the author, the perfecter of faith. Maybe there's a word for somebody here this morning about that. As you look back, the stuff that you have thought or said or done, the things that still affect you, maybe that sense of self-condemnation, stuff that you can no longer affect as you look back. Jesus says, go now, live, live looking forwards. Jesus isn't compromising. He's not compromising about your past and my past. He's not saying it doesn't matter. He's not saying the stuff that was done to you when you were small didn't hurt. It did. Those things that were said or spoken over you, or the stuff that you lived through that were painful and difficult, Jesus doesn't say those things don't matter. They absolutely matter. But they matter as we bring them to him. As we say, Lord, I don't want to live dominated by my past. I want to live dictated by you for the future. I wonder what it is that you're still holding on to this morning that dictates your present, that you might want to just simply let go. Jesus isn't compromising. And finally, in this passage, it's my observation that Jesus isn't condemning. Jesus straightened up and asked her, woman, where are they? I love that question because it was obvious, wasn't it? It's an obvious question. Where are they? And in that little three-line question, which I suppose we could have added to our list of questions, where are they? You get an idea of course, they can't condemn you because they have no right. They aren't perfect. They've done things wrong themselves. Jesus says, where are they? And then the question that sits before us this morning, has no one condemned you? Nobody, sir. Then neither do I condemn you. And the word that Jesus uses here for condemn is kind of a word linked to the writing word. It literally means to make judgment against. Ever been picked out for sort of a finger pointing moment in your past, in your life? Have you ever been hung out to dry at work where a mistake's been made and the finger's been pointed at you? You ever been hung out to dry like that? This is the word here that's being used. It's a picked out for judgment word. And Jesus is saying, I do not do that for you. Jesus never highlights anybody in order that they might be judged and condemned. Jesus focuses on us in that we might be freed and forgiven, set free. Jesus maybe had Psalm 103 in mind. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. Some of us here this morning don't believe it. You may have lived in church for many decades. You may have tried your hardest to live a Christian life in the best way that you possibly can. But somehow deep inside resides this fear that somehow God isn't like this. That he looks at you, and maybe he looks at only you, as the one who the finger points at. You ever feel like that? It says the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. That means overflowing in love. And the most famous verse in the New Testament, you know, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shouldn't perish, but have eternal life. Do you know what the next bit says? It says this, God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Jesus' purpose is always to rescue, is always to bring freedom. It's always to look at the stuff that we may have thought, said, or done and to want forgiveness to flow. And he's done everything that makes it possible. He died on the cross so that we wouldn't have to. He rose from the dead to show that he has the power over life and death. He beat it, death, in order to demonstrate that he'd beaten wrongdoing in the world. And although we see pain and suffering around us, it's the ultimate truth that everything will be made new in and through Jesus. That's his purpose. That's his reason. That's the heart of God, so that we wouldn't have to stand as condemned people. When Paul wrote to the Romans church, he picked that sentiment up and he said, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Not to live under judgment anymore. If you're here this morning feeling like you're living under judgment, wondering what the heart of God looks like, and maybe you've been listening to me and it's been words that have been pouring over your head because you've heard it before. Maybe this little moment captured on video will highlight what the face of God looks like in the face of our fears and our hurts and our sin. Does no one condemn you? No, sir. Neither do I condemn you. Go and leave your life of sin. Live differently going forward. Let's stand together, shall we, as we respond to these things today. If I had a pound for every time somebody said to me, nice sermon, vicar, I'd be a rich man. But we have a moment this morning not just to say these are great words, recounted from John 8, but to say, Lord, what would this mean for me to live differently? Maybe to live more compassionately for others and over others. Maybe to bring my own life before Jesus and say, Lord, I want to hear what you have to say about me, to hear his voice that says to you, does nobody condemn you, nor do I. There's a moment of response, I think, that's needed. For us again to respond and to give ourselves to Jesus, to wait for his call again in our lives that says, I do not condemn you. I want to give you life. And if this morning you've been living under the shadow of condemnation, maybe you've been a Christian for a while and yet still unable to get over how condemnatory you are about yourself, then there's a team available to pray with us today here at the front and also at the back. They'll be available right towards the end as people are filtering out for coffee. If you want to take that as your moment, then feel free. If you've lived under the shadow of the condemnation of other people's words, then there's a moment to break free from that. Let somebody pray for you so that you could hear again the voice of Jesus saying, I do not condemn you. And for us to live life once more.